So that was SRAM operation, and now we'll just have a short section. So traditional SRAM layout I'm going to show you over here, which is like a tall cell. We have our 60 cells shown over here in the corner. And what we're going to do is we're going to start with our cross-coupled inverter pair. So M1 and M3 you can see over here, and M4 and M6 over here. And we have our poly gate that's going to be driving them, and our Q and Q bar with the transistor diffusions over here and here. We're going to add extend the diffusions over here of M1 and M4 throw the word line across them, and then we can continue routing with the poly over here, which can be extended throughout the line, so we can then just put a lot more of these copies of the cell, and the poly line will get to the output of the decoder. Same thing that we're going to do, and this is an important part of all these types of very tight designs. We want to share as many contacts and as many metal connections and so forth as we can, because it actually shrinks the size of the cell, and we don't have to keep all kinds of DRCs, all kinds of spacing rules. So what we're going to do is we're going to throw the bitline and bitline bar, which are vertically routed through the cell, and even the contacts that go down, or the via stacks that go down from these higher layer metals, like this would be a metal 2, down to the diffusions that are down below, they are actually shared between two adjacent cells. So essentially the cell ends at the middle of this contact, or the middle of this via, and the next cell starts here for measurement sakes. Then the next thing is we're going to do is going to share power and ground. So luckily VDD and ground, they are both routed horizontally and vertically, so we can share them on either side. So in this case, we can have VDD going through on metal 1, and again, it can be shared at the sides of the cells. And here we're going to go down with a via and a contact down to the diffusions over here. So again, the cell can be cut off right in the middle of the contact over here, and we can actually share this diffusion over here with the next cell as well, and we don't have to waste the diffusion space to the next cell. Okay, same can be said about ground, which can be that can be routed, for example, vertically. And then again, since this will be connected over here to M1 and over here to M4, this diffusion can be shared with the left and right cells, and the whole ground type of thing can be shared with the top and bottom cells. And again, we can basically cut our cell in the middle here, and the size of our cell comes out from the middle of this metal, through the middle of that, through the middle of these contacts. And this is the size of our cell when using this layout approach. Here you can see an actual type of a layout in one of these older technologies. And that's what used to be used. This was a tall cell. And you see one of the things that comes out of this is that we have a thinner width than we do a height, which may be good and may not be good. It means our bit lines are going to be longer. They're going to have more capacitance on them. It gives us more room to make our actually post decoder, which needs to be pitch fit over here and drive things horizontally, but it means that we're going to have a taller SRAM macro, and we'll have to fold it more. A bunch of things happened when we started to go into more scaled technologies, and one of them is that bends in polysilicon and diffusion become either very difficult to do, very restricted, or they're not allowed at all. So we need to avoid bends in the polysilicon and diffusion. That's number one. Number two is that all the transistors have to usually be nowadays oriented in one direction. So you can't have transistors that are in the same, you can't have transistors that are both made like this and transistors that are made like this. They all have to be in one direction or the other. And that's a hard constraint. Another thing that just I wanted to mention is that the bit line is what causes a limit on the read delay. And so we want to minimize the bit line capacitance, because these are small transistors inside that are discharging the bit lines. So we want to have the capacitance as small as possible. So when we stack a lot of these on top of each other, the overall capacitance will be small. So that's where the thin cell comes in. And here's a picture of a thin cell. And this is the type of SRAM basically that is used today. And let's see how it's made. So First, we have M2 and M5. So these are our access transistors over here, M2 and M5. And we know that they have to be connected to the word lines, okay? And they have to be connected to Q and to the bit line and bit line bar. So you can see that the bit line is over here writing over this, and the bit line bar is writing over M5. And then we can just drop our contact down to the diffusion. That's this diffusion and this diffusion, and share it with the next cell. And that's why, we are basically sharing this and sharing this, and then we can stack these guys real easily. Okay, the other side there then is going to be Q or QB. Okay, and so Q and QB now need to be connected to other things too. So if we take Q, right, on the one hand, it's connected to M2, and QB is one hand connected to M5, but it also has to connect to M3, M1, M6, and M4. Okay, well, remember that we need to have different wells and different active areas for NMOSes and PMOSes, and this M2 and M4 and M5 are NMOSes, so they should be really sharing with M1 and M4, and we really do make M1 and M4 over on the other side of them. So we can see here that this and this will be M1 and M4, and you see that the transistors are oriented the same. So this is the poly, this is the poly, right? This is the poly. This is the poly. All these transistors are oriented the same. We now share the diffusion that gives us Q and Q bar. And on the other side of M1 and M4, what we have is ground. So that means that this contact over here and this contact over here are going to be ground. And again, ground is something that is shared, so we can share it with guys who are on top of us and share the contact over there and share the line that may be running on top of that. Okay, it also means that this area now has to be NMOS. This has to be NMOS, and this area has to be NMOS. But we can make this area PMOS. And then again, we can just stack these guys on top of each other and once in a while put well taps in there. But our wells are really shared. Actually, the NMOS, if we flip these guys, we can share the P well over here with the P well over here. Okay, so what we're going to do now is make our PMOS transistors here in the middle, and we see these are M6 and M3 that are going to be over there in the middle, and on one side of M6 and M3 we're going to have VDD. M6 and M3 are going to be connected to VDD on one side, the other side they're going to be connected to QB and to Q. So that's how this thin cell is made, with a maximum sharing, and we got a really small cell. And these are actually, again, as I said, we use push rules to make these even smaller and tighter. Here we can see a more actual industrial example in a 65 nanometer process. You can see it's a bit strange over here, but it's pretty much what I showed you on the previous slide. And when you usually see pictures of these things, you see this pair of polys like this. Always, this is when you see an area like this in a SEM, that's the SRAM area. So if we look at commercial SRAMs, SRAM is really the most important cell, most important circuit that we have in all processes, because it takes up so much of the chip area. And in fact, what they do usually is they develop first the SRAM for a new technology, fabricate it, show they can get high yield, see what kind of tricks they can play with the layout to make it even smaller than minimum design rules, and tape out a couple of SRAM test chips. And then they develop the logic rules for the process. So what you can see is that the cell size of the SRAM really was able to be reduced throughout many feature sizes. You see here some figures from Intel and IBM. Okay, and if we look at some pictures of that, you can see these are the tall cells that we saw before in 130 and 90 nanometers, which turned into the thin cells in 65 and below. And you really have to have these really perfect structures. This is often done with a double etch, where we make a long line and then we just cut it at non-minimum rules to actually meet this type of a thing. You can see that there are also different types of bit cells nowadays. You will have things like high density bit cells, low voltage bit cells, high speed bit cells. They'll be a bit different. Some of the high density will be a bit smaller. The low voltage bit cells will have a bit better capability of working at low voltage. The high speed will have a bit larger drive strength and maybe faster sense amplifiers and decoders. And you can usually compile different types of these SRAMs according to your needs, and they will trade off your area and your power consumption versus your access. So some very recent SRAMs that I was able to find, and again, the foundries don't like to really show these things too much, so you only can find some things in recent publications like ISCCC or IEDM, but here are some things that I was able to find. So up here you see a 7-nanometer SRAM from TSMC, and you see again this really nice structure. These of course are FinFET structures. But it's really very dense and nice. And here you can see a 5-nanometer SRAM test chip that TSMC published, and you can see the again bit cell area that keeps on shrinking, which enables us to really keep Moore's law alive, because if we want a tighter and a better functioning chip, we need to have smaller SRAM. And so you can see here that this is 135 megabit high density SRAM that was done in 5-nanometer technology in ISSCC 2020. Okay, Samsung has recently published a 3-nanometer gate all-around SRAM test chip. So you can see it over here, and they show a vertical TEM image. They don't show a nicer picture of it, but we already do know that there are 3-nanometer processes that are being fabricated. SRAM has not scaled as well as logic actually since 7 or 5 nanometers or so, but they do continue to scale it somewhat, which makes the next process technology feasible. So that was a bit about SRAM layout, and now we can move on to SRAM stability.